published since the invention of the printing press, and the best answer he could come up with was something over 6 billion copies of God's Word has been published since the printing press was invented. But what got me excited and made me so pleased that I am a part of the Gideon ministry was that means the Gideons have been responsible for placing a third of the Bibles that are in use in the world today. And even though I'm bragging on the Gideons pretty much this morning, I still want to emphasize the fact the Gideons could not do what we do without the support of the local church. And your church has always been very supportive of the Gideons. I've seen your giving record to the Gideons, so I know how supportive you are, and we appreciate that. But even though the Gideons are placing Bibles at the rate of about two and a half Bibles every time your heart beats, the request for Bibles and the need for funds has never been greater than it is today. You know, sometime here in the United States, we have trouble even giving a Bible away. But in some other countries, they're begging for scriptures. And many times, the Gideons will not ship scriptures unless the money is there to pay for them. So many times, we're holding orders waiting for the money to show up. Brother Hans was privileged on Friday night to hear several Gideon presentations at our pastor's appreciation dinner. He may use some of it in his sermon, but it's an awesome ministry. And even though, as I say, we're placing Bibles at a very rapid rate, the request for Bibles and the need for funds has never been greater than it is today. And here's some ways that you can help. Number one, pray for the Gideon ministry. Pray that funds will continue to flow in so that Bibles can be bought and that doors will continue to open in countries and communities that need them the most. Secondly, I would encourage you to use the Gideon Card Bible program. You have a display out in the foyer. It needs servicing. It needs some more cards in it, and I'll make sure the local Gideons understand that you need some more cards in your Gideon card rack. The Gideon Card program is a great way to honor someone and support the Gideon ministries at the same time. You know, there's cards in there for memorials, thanking of you, special recognition, like, you know, graduations are not far off. Somebody's graduating from school. It's a great way to honor them by giving to the Gideon ministry. And then thirdly, I would ask you to consider, you men, if I've said something today that piques your interest in the Gideon ministry, see me after service. We're always looking for good men and women. Yes, women are involved in our ministry. Glenda ministers with me as a part of what we call the auxiliary. The only issue is for a woman to get involved in the Gideon auxiliary, her husband has to be a Gideon. So, ladies, if you think you would like to do some things that our auxiliary does, you need to encourage your husband to join the Gideons. Where, as I say, any men in here that are retired or nearing retirement? You don't want to admit it? The reason I mention that, it's a great place for you, if you are. Many times younger families are very busy and they don't have time to really engage in the ministry like they'd like to. But newly retired men are great prospects, and we work on them pretty heavily because they need something to do, you know. I've been retired now, sort of retired, I guess I should say, since 07, and I don't know how I ever had time to work. Anyway, consider joining the Gideon ministry, but keep in mind, all Gideons have to be recommended by their pastor, so at some point in your application process, the pastor is called, and if you're in good standing with the church, then he'll give you the okay to be a Gideon. And then lastly, and I told Glenda last night as I was going over my notes for this morning, I said, I didn't bring my empty box. I'm getting ready to ask for the offering, and I usually bring an empty box up here that, like our Bibles are shipped in, and I show the audience, the congregation, that the box is empty. But I said, for $125, this box can be filled with 100 of these testaments and shipped anywhere in the world. And I call it my empty box challenge. Well, I don't have my empty box with me today, but I still challenge you to give generously to the ministry. And at the close of service today, you'll have an opportunity to give to the Gideon Ministry. And the brother and I discussed this morning that if you want to write a check, write it to the church, and then he'll write us one check for the offering before we leave today. So, I want to say thank you for allowing us to come speak about the worldwide ministry of the Gideons International. Thank you for your attention. It's our pleasure to be a part of your worship service today, and may God bless you.
Playing that little happy music now, right?
Come on down.
There you go.
There we go. Good morning. Can y'all hear me through this thing? Am I on? Okay. I'm trying to work the sound and do children's sermons this morning. How's it going? Good, good. Welcome. It's good to see you guys. Y'all know what's just around the corner, right? Easter. It's coming right up. It got me thinking about some things. I got to reminiscing about Easter egg hunts. You guys like to hunt Easter eggs? Yeah, I used to hunt Easter eggs too. Things have changed a lot since I was your age and I hunted Easter eggs. Used to, when I was young, we had a prize egg. Y'all still have a prize egg?
Yeah.
With dollars in it, yeah. Well, that's one thing that's changed. When I was young, it was a dollar in it. I bet some folks remember in here when it was a nickel. Things have changed a lot over the years. Now, yeah, some prize eggs have like $5 or $10 in them. Some, I think, even more. But it's kind of the treasure egg, right? Because Easter egg hunting is kind of like treasure hunting, ain't it? Yeah, we all kind of get out in a big space, and they're hidden all over the place, kind of like a hidden treasure, and we all go out and we start looking for them. What happens when somebody, and it's not you, finds the prize egg? No, no. Well, I'll tell you what happened when I was young and somebody else found the prize egg. A little bit of air went out of me. I said, oh, but only for a moment, right? Does that ever happen to you guys? If somebody else says, I found it, and holds up the prize egg, don't you kind of sigh to yourself a little bit? But then just for a second, but then I kicked right back in. Oh, yeah, I forgot. There's a bunch of other eggs that's got chocolate in them. And what happens when all the eggs are gone and there ain't no eggs, more eggs to be found? Does that happen again? I used to kind of say, oh, we're out of eggs, right? Because those were the treasure. That was the treasure. It was supposed to be found, and somebody else has kind of done found it, and it went away. And that's what happens. You know, we get all excited about treasures because that's where our heart is at. We're thinking about that treasure egg that's got that dollar or those dollars in it. We're all excited about it until it's gone. And then our hearts turn toward the eggs that's got all the chocolate in it and the candy. To be honest with you, that's where my heart goes first in Easter egg hunting. But we kind of turn to those eggs, and then they're all gone. It's kind of, and then we turn our attention to something else, like playing, right? And that's our treasure at the moment. And that's where our heart goes to, and we run off to it. It got me thinking about this Bible verse that I've read. It comes out of Luke chapter 12. And it's verse 34, and it kind of sums that up. It says, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. You know what that means? Huh? You do? Well, what it means is that your heart's going to go to wherever your treasure is at. Just like that Easter egg that's got the money in it. That's the first thing on our minds, and that's what we're all looking for, right? And then when it gets found, our heart goes to the next treasure, to that Easter egg that's got all the chocolate candy in it. And then when all those are found, our heart goes to the next treasure, right? The playground. And then when it's time to go home, we kind of just keep going on. The Bible says there is a treasure that can't be taken away from you. Did you know that? And it says to lay up treasures for yourself in heaven. Jesus Christ is our treasure. One of these days, I'm going to be rewarded for all the work that I've done here, and you guys can be too. You guys can be too. It says, lay up for yourselves treasure in heaven, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Turn your hearts to Jesus. Turn your hearts to Jesus, because there is an awesome treasure that comes along with that. An unbelievable one. The Bible says we can't even imagine that. Nobody's ever seen anything like it. Nobody's ever heard anything like it. We can't imagine anything like it. Can you just think to yourself what kind of treasure that must be? Doesn't that sound awesome? If you took an egg with money in it in this hand, and the treasure of heaven in it in this hand, I think the scales would go like that. Wait a minute. That. I got it backwards. Right? Yep. So as you're hunting Easter eggs this year, or just going through life in general, I want you to think about something. The treasures that we see every day, they're here 1 minute and they're gone the next. Okay? And we kind of turn our attention toward them. And sometimes we turn our hearts into them, and we put a lot of effort into getting our hands on those treasures, like that treasure egg. But they'll be here 1 minute and gone the next. I want you to remember, there is a treasure. There is a treasure that is eternal and will be there forever. Okay? It'll be there forever, and nobody can take it away from you. Even if Charlie gets there first, I still got treasure. All right? Let's say a prayer and thank God for that. Our Heavenly Father, God, Lord, we thank you for this day, God. We thank you for the Bible. Lord, we thank you that in it you tell us, God, that you have a treasure waiting on us, Lord. You said that you have gone to prepare a place for us, Lord. You have gone to prepare treasure. And God, we just pray that you'll lead our hearts to lay up treasures in heaven, God, because where our treasure is, there is our heart also, Lord. God, we just thank you that you are our treasure, Lord, that you're everything that we've ever searched for and we've ever hoped for, God, and that one day, we're going to get our hands on that treasure, Lord, and we're going to spend eternity with you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Off to our hymn this morning, number 772, When We All Get to Heaven. If our ushers will come down this morning on the last verse, it will be greatly appreciated. Let's all stand. Thank you.
Bobby, lead us in prayer.
Love.
us. Antioch Baptist Church is in all activities to glorify God as the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We call saints to worship and sinners to repentance.
Come on up, Hans. I want to make one more announcement. Mandy told me, don't forget about our security seminar. It is March the 28th at 6 o'clock. Women and men, show up. Please be here. We've got somebody coming from Atlanta or the upstate there to take care of our missions. Jim, you going to be at the back door with open Bible? I know you forgot your box, but you're going to be. So y'all give freely. Y'all heard what they said, what one box cost and how many to be reached. It's all yours, Hans.
Amen. Glad you're here this morning. Are you glad you're here? Yeah. Who left the air conditioner on, though, last night? Huh? Josh, I was thinking about when you came up here and you said you asked the kids, do you like to hunt Easter eggs? I'm wondering, what kind of rifle you use for that? What kind of load do you use to hunt Easter eggs? And if you use black powder, do you get to hunt them longer? I mean, I'm just wondering. Hey, as you're thinking about giving to the Gideons as we finish up today, let me just mention a couple of things to you, because I've been a long supporter of the Gideons and appreciate their ministry so much. Had the pleasure of sending several of former church members to the Gideons to help out. But one way you can help out your church treasurer is if in the memo line you write Gideons. Okay, if you write a check, write Gideons in that memo line, and that way they don't get it mixed up with other things. The other thing is that, you know, a lot of times when we go to funerals and stuff, we see all kinds of flowers and everything, and those flowers fade, but the Word of God remains. And so if you give the scriptures to be placed with the Gideons, they'll go out throughout the world, and people will come to know Jesus Christ. And those flowers are pretty, don't get me wrong, and I don't want to take anything away from them. But I think many of us in here would agree. We'd much rather see a scripture being placed that goes out in the minds of hearts. And what's the, it's like 12 people or so that every single scripture touches.
A hotel Bible such as this has the potential of reaching in a 6-year life. We changed them out. We changed them out. The potential of reaching 2,300 people.
2,300 people with one Bible. I dare say there aren't a lot of churches that can do that. And so praise God for that. And as far as Elliot's testimony, I got to hear him in person a couple of years back, and that is quite the testimony. Brother Jim did a great job with it, but to hear Brother Elliot tell it, it's absolutely amazing, is it not? Amen. Let's pray together. Lord, I thank you so much for today, and I thank you for Antioch Baptist Church. And Lord, what a blessing it was to be able to hear from the Gideons this morning. We pray your blessings upon that ministry, and thank you so much. And we pray, God, that even now you would continue to be calling men and women into that ministry to serve you and to distribute Bibles. Father, we know that the fields are wide unto harvest, and the laborers are few. And so, Father, we are praying right now to the Lord of the harvest to send more laborers. God, we know that everything here is owned by you, and so you will provide the necessary funds, and we thank you for that. But Lord, we know you give it and put it in our hearts to help out with this ministry, so we appreciate that today. Now, Lord, we thank you for the music that we've heard today, and what a wonderful job the choir has done, and Charlie, and thank you so much for this church. Now, Lord, as we open your word, would you speak to us through your word, and help prepare our hearts that we may honor and glorify you. In Christ's name we humbly pray. Amen. Do you like being around people? Not everybody does, but I like being around people, sort of. I can be around people for a while, but there are times when I got to be by myself, right? And I know some of you understand what I'm talking about, because you hunt and you fish by yourself, right? And you'll tell me, well, I'm just getting out there, and I'm seeing nature, and I'm thinking about all the great. And that's great, I hear you, but sometimes we just need to be alone with our thoughts, right? We need to have some time to ourself. And that's enjoyable until it goes on too long. And then it's no longer enjoyable. In fact, it becomes uncomfortable, maybe even unnerving and scary. 5 months after my son Silas here was born, I had to receive a radioactive iodine treatment following my thyroid cancer surgery. You see, I didn't know this before I got cancer, but your organs, see, I always thought of organs kind of like parts of a car. If you had something taken out, they take the whole thing out in one shot, right? It was very easy. Like, if I open up the hood and I say, okay, well, that's my alternator. I need a new alternator. I need a new battery, or I need new spark plugs or something like that. I just change those things out. I don't have to worry about anything being left over from that alternator or that battery or anything along those lines. Your organs are not like that, though. Your organs are more like a Krispy Kreme donut. No, really. Those of you who are medical professionals, you know what I'm talking about. You're more like a Krispy Kreme donut. You take the donut out of the box, and you've got most of that donut in your hand, but you look down in the box, and what do you see? There's some leftovers down in that box, right? That sooner or later, they're going to go somewhere. There's leftovers, and you can't ever get all of that donut in one shot, right? And you look kind of funny going, don't point, okay? Your organs are kind of like that. When they take an organ out, there may be some cells left over. And for me, with my thyroid, I had thyroid cancer, and that kind of thyroid cancer that I had only attacks your thyroid cells. And since you can have thyroid cells like all the way down into your chest, and it's supposed to be in your neck, they give you a radioactive iodine treatment which tricks your thyroid cells into taking in the iodine, and then it kills them. That's what they do. Well, I was led into this room in the basement of a hospital in Columbia, South Carolina, and they bring in my pill jar, no joke, in a lead container. It's a little scary, y'all. I won't lie. Before they bring this lead container out, they say, now you need to understand, you can't be near anyone, in proximity of anyone, for 7 days. And you can't be around small children for 10 days. Now, I'm a father of a 5-month-old. And I know he doesn't look it now, but he was much smaller then. So I had to be away from my family for about 12 days, actually, in all. And so they bring in this pill bottle in this lead container, and the nurse leaves the room with the lead container and a cup of water. The reason being is, what was going to help me could hurt you. What was going to help me by destroying all the thyroid cells left in my body, I became radioactive and I could have hurt somebody else. So I wasn't allowed to be around anyone. So for the next 7 days, for the next 7 hours, I enjoyed being by myself. Because I like to get off by myself from time to time. But it became uncomfortable. And then it became miserable. And then it became painful to be by myself for so long. Have you ever been alone for so long that it was painful? Maybe you got lost at a school field trip. Maybe you were in a hospital and your family couldn't stay with you overnight. Maybe you had to take a long trip by yourself and you felt very alone. Or worse, maybe you felt spiritually alone. You ever felt like God wasn't listening? You ever felt like your prayers were bouncing off the ceiling? You ever felt like when you were crying out to Him, when you were pleading with Him, when you were making your case to Him, it didn't seem like He was paying attention? Like he was playing a game on his cell phone or texting somebody or on Facebook. You ever felt that way? To me, that was the worst part of being alone during those 7 days, because there was a time when I felt like God wasn't paying attention to me. Like he wasn't listening to me. But more than that, it felt honestly like he was ignoring me. And I felt like he had forsaken me. Last week, if you were here, we began looking at pictures of Jesus from the Old Testament. We call them prophecies. And this morning, we're going to do that again, and we're going to look at what I think is one of the most chilling prophecies in all the Old Testament about the Savior, and it's found in the 22nd Psalm. If you have your copy of God's Word, I encourage you to turn with me to the 22nd Psalm. Psalm chapter 22, starting in verse 1, reads this. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me and from the words of my groaning? Now already in this verse, in this phrase, we've heard something. Many of us have heard something familiar, haven't we? We've already heard something that we recognize. Where have we heard this phrase before? My God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus cries this out from the cross. In Matthew 27, verse 46, it says, and in the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus, in the moment, in that moment, while he's hanging on the cross, identifies himself with the person who is the subject of the 22nd Psalm. He's identifying with it, and he's reminding those present of what it said. And those who knew the Old Testament well, those Pharisees, those scribes, those people who were present at the foot of the cross, would very well recognize what Jesus was saying there, and they should have perked up and realized that it was all too familiar. It would be just like if somebody were to walk in this church singing Amazing Grace. Right? We would all join in. We know what they're singing. And Jesus is basically saying, this psalm is about me. So let's see if it bears any resemblance to his experience. Look again, verse 1. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me? And from the words of my groaning, oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not hear. And in the night season, and I'm not silent, but you are holy, enthroned in the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in you. They trusted and you delivered them. They cried to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not ashamed. Jesus knows what it's like to feel abandoned and alone, forsaken even. I cannot imagine. But I think about those kids who've been disowned by their parents for one reason or another. And my heart breaks for those kids. No matter what the situation, it breaks for those children. I think about the kids. You remember there was a rash a few years ago about children, toddlers, being left in cars only to expire because they were in a hot car for too long. And I even put out a plea, hey, if you've got that much going on in your life, bring your kid to me. If you got that much going on in your life or you just can't handle being a parent anymore, bring your child to me. Don't let that child perish. And now here is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords with his arms wide, hanging on a cross. And the religious leaders should have recognized them. They were familiar with the Scriptures. They taught the Scriptures. And yet they didn't see Jesus as Messiah, but rather as Maverick. And they to them, he was a sinner and not the Savior. They should have seen him for who he was, but they willfully ignored the signs. Verse 6 through 8. David proclaims, but I am a worm. And no man, a reproach of men, and despised by these people. All those who see me ridicule me. They shoot out the lip. They shake their head, saying, he trusted in the Lord. Let him rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Again, if you're familiar with the gospel account of Jesus being crucified, we are faced with things that we have heard before here in this passage. Jesus was despised. He was hated. How do we know? Because when the children of Israel had the opportunity on that day to free Jesus, who had never once sinned. Do you get the enormity of that? He never told a lie as a kid. He never had a lustful thought in his mind. He never had hatred in his heart toward those people who were constantly showing hatred to him. You see that? And they had the choice to either let him go or Barabbas, who was, for all intents and purposes, the Osama bin Laden of the day. He was a horrible terrorist man. And yet they chose the lawbreaker over the lawgiver. Jesus knew what it felt like to be forsaken. He also knew what it felt like to be mocked, to be teased so terribly. You remember what we used to say when we were little? Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words may never hurt me. You remember that? What a bunch of hooey. Right? That's a lie we tell ourselves to keep us from crying in public. Sorry. Some of us have been picked on so much that what we really wanted to do was go behind a door and cry and never come out. And you know what? Jesus has been in that place too. He's been there. And worse. Because not only did they mock him, and Lord, did they mock him, they mocked his father. Look back at verse 8. He trusted in the Lord. Let him rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. And all this is written 1,000 years before Jesus is on the cross. And in Matthew chapter 27, verse 43, we read, he trusted in God. Let him deliver him now if he will have him. For he said, I am the Son of God. This is almost word for word. You see, this is what makes the situation so disheartening, so difficult to understand. Jesus relied on his Father his entire life. Look on in verse 9 and 10. But you are he who took me out of the womb. You made me trust while I was on my mother's breast. I was cast upon you from birth, from my mother's womb. You have been my God. But now he feels abandoned by the one that he has already known. And to make matters worse, he knew this was coming. From the moment that Jesus stepped out of heaven and into the hot, sweaty sea of humanity, from the time that he chose to limit his power and presence so that he could be confined to the space of a mere mortal man and yet still be fully God, before all of this, Jesus knew that day was coming. It was on the horizon. It was not a surprise. It was not the fine print at the bottom of a 45-page contract that you're unaware and you don't realize it's in there. No, Jesus knew. He knew all along that there would be this day and it would come and how painful it would be and how lonely he would be. And he went anyway. Not just to say that he did it. Not just to say, whew, glad that's over with. Not just to have some sort of Guinness Book of World Record or some man-made title. No, he became forsaken so you and I don't have to be. He became forsaken so you and I don't have to be. He took on our worst so we could receive his best. His purpose was not restitution, but restoration. He wanted to restore our relationship with God. But in order to do that, for a brief moment, he had to be cut off from the Lord. And so Christ is relating to his distant relative, his great, 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 great grandpa, King David. I think I got enough greats in there, maybe too many. When in the midst of his own trial, he pleaded with the Lord. Verse 11, be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. Jesus was in the same predicament. Trouble was near him. No one was able to prevent it. And what would happen that day? Jesus was forsaken and he was mocked and he was abandoned. And as painful as it is to say, It was ordained by God the Father. Yes, our picture of Jesus today shows very plainly the cross that Jesus died upon to buy our pardon, to forgive us of our sins, to cleanse us from our unrighteousness, and to adopt us into the family of God. But the cross of Christ is not the only cross the Bible speaks of. In Luke chapter 9, verse 23, Jesus says, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me." Charles Spurgeon, great preacher from the 1800s, once said, "You have not the making of your own cross, although unbelief is a master carpenter at cross making. Neither are you permitted to choose your own cross, although self-will would fain be your Lord and Master. But your cross is prepared and appointed for you by divine love, and you are cheerfully to accept it. You are to take up the cross as your chosen badge and burden, and not to stand cavilling at it. This night, Jesus bids you submit your shoulder to his easy yoke, not kick at it in petulance or trample on it in vainglory, but or fall under it in despair or run away from it in fear, but take it up like a true follower of Jesus. Jesus was a cross bearer. He leads the way in the path of sorrow. Surely you could not desire a better guide. And if he carried a cross, what noble burden could you desire? The Via Della Rosa is the way of safety. Fear not to tread its thorny path." Beloved, the cross is not made of feathers, nor lined with velvet. It is heavy and galling to disobedient shoulders, but it is not an iron cross, although your fears may have painted it with iron colors. It is a wooden cross, and men can carry it, for the man of sorrows tried the load. Take up your cross, and by the power of the Spirit of God, you will soon be so in love with it that, like Moses, you would not dare exchange the reproach of Christ for all the treasures of Egypt. Remember that Jesus carried it, and it will smell sweetly. Remember that it will soon be followed by the crown, and the thought of the coming weight of glory will greatly lighten the present heaviness of trouble. The Lord will help you bow your spirit in submission to the divine will ere you fall asleep this night, that the waking with tomorrow's sun, you may go forth to the day's cross with the holy and submissive spirit, which becomes a follower of the crucified." Amazing words. Very true. On that day, 14 years ago, I made a choice that would kill something inside of me, so small, microscopic. A couple of cells here, a cell there, and yet those cells had the potential to kill me from the inside out. But as I look back, that was not the first time I made that choice. No, the first time I made that choice was when I was 12 years old, and I invited Jesus Christ to be my Lord and Savior. On that day, He took my sin, and He gave me His cross. That was the cure for the cancer of sin that was in my body already. Why? Because, as Thomas Brooks put it, Christ's blood is heaven's key. Remember what Jesus said? "For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it." It's interesting, and I don't know if any of you have had thyroid cancer or issues with your thyroid, but because of that surgery, I have to take medicine every day in order to replace the hormones in my body that my thyroid controlled. My heart rate, my metabolism, which, as you can tell, is working overtime. I mean, I haven't felt this great in years, or at least seconds. every day. And if I don't take it, if I skip a dose, my body says, hold on a second, something's not right here. In fact, in order to take that radioactive iodine treatment, I had to get off of my medicine for 2 weeks. And understand this, your thyroid regulates your sleep, it regulates your heartbeat, it regulates all sorts of things in your body. Can you imagine not having those things go right for 2 weeks? It was difficult, to say the least. So now every day I take a dose of Synthroid, levothyroxine. Takes care of that. But you know what I discovered? If I will be in the Word of God every day, that's another kind of dose that I need. That's another kind of help that I need each and every day. If I will spend time in the Word of God each and every day, if I will take up my cross daily and follow Him every day, then that makes an impact on me and it makes an impact on those around me, a positive impact. So what about you this morning? Have you trusted Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord? Have you taken up that burden? Have you put Him into your life? Have you allowed Him to take up your worst and give you His best? Have you done that? Because if you haven't this morning, this is a great opportunity. It's a great time because Jesus is here and He's calling. Or maybe this morning you've been worshiping here at Antioch for a while and you know this is where God is calling you to serve Him. Not come and worship, which you do, you gather together to worship, but you gather together to worship and to serve. It's funny, and I won't dwell on this long because I promise you I wouldn't be long-winded. They got to go all the way to Rome, y'all. But Jesus, you know, have you ever wondered what you could do to show Jesus love? You ever wondered that? You ever wondered, what is it that I can do to show Jesus how much I appreciate all that He's done for me? Because you recognize there's nothing you can really do to pay Him back for what He's done, right? So what we can do is show Him love. And Jesus told us how to do that. He explicitly said, if you love me, obey my commandments. So obedience to Christ is what we do to show Him we love Him. And I have to ask myself, how am I doing? I mean, my grandfather told my grandmother, one day she asked him after like 20 years of marriage, why don't you ever tell me you love me anymore? And he said, well, if that ever changes, I'll let you know. You know I love you, but if it ever changes, I'll let you know. And it never changed. Ever. We can't be like that with Jesus. Obedience is a cross to bear. Obedience is following Him. So, maybe God is calling you into relationship with Him. Maybe God is calling you to serve Him here. Maybe God's calling you to be praying for somebody here at this altar this morning. Or maybe God is calling you into not just a relationship with Him, but into His service. As a missionary, as a pastor, as a youth leader, as a WMU director. Some way that God is calling you to serve Him as a Gideon. Some way. And if that's you this morning and you don't know that for certain, if that's a new calling upon your life, I'd love to talk to you about that as well. Charlie and the instruments are going to go ahead and come and we're going to have a time of invitation. It's a time for you to respond as the Lord would lead. But before we do any of that, not only should we, but we need to give this time over to the Lord. So let's do that. Lord, thank You for today. Thank You for this opportunity to come together and gather.